Okay, let's turn the Bible to Psalm 33 for starting place tonight. Book of Psalms, number 33. This class that we are doing on Thursday nights on the history of our Bible, we finish the service, and Brother Steve cleans it up a little bit and puts it out on that internet, the World Wide Web, internet, a dangerous thing, but there it is, just like a tape player, just like a car, just like a stereo, has no life of its own. It's not an evil thing, it's not a good thing, it's just a thing. Nothing's unclean of itself. When a dirty man with a dirty mind and a dirty heart picks up a guitar, he can make dirty sounds. And when a clean man with a clean mind and a clean heart picks up a guitar, he can make clean sounds. So we use the radio. We don't think radio is good or bad. It's just a thing. We use it. We don't think the internet's good or bad. It's just a thing. We use it. But anyway, we put that stuff out on the internet. And man, here it comes. Here's 101 contradictions in the Bible. Somebody took the time to send me. Here's another stack here of 20-some. Here's 64 in this list. Here's 8. I challenge you, I dare you to try and answer these, you hypocrite. From one of the brethren. Yeah. Anyway, Bible says in Psalm 33 and verse number 4, for the word of the Lord was right, and all his works are done in truth. I don't believe I read that correctly. I believe just what the book says. I believe the word of the Lord is right. I don't think it used to be, and I'm trying to get back to a day when it was. I don't think it used to be, and I'm trying to find the place where it was. I believe that it is right. Now here's the sad thing. One of these big stacks of contradictions comes complete with answers from somebody who is supposedly defending the Bible. And all of the answers refer me to which Greek manuscript or new version I need to go to clear up the discrepancy or the problem. That doesn't help. So we're going to tackle some of these tonight and then next time and the time after. And what I want you to see is that really these problems and these contradictions are nothing more than what we keep running into. An inability of people to read. I mean, most problems in the Bible are only problems because people aren't reading at a fifth grade level. And they read something, and well, it's not even that. I'm satisfied after 25 years of preaching and dealing with people that don't want to get right with God, they just want to argue with what you said. I'm satisfied that only one man in 1,000 has ever come across a contradiction in the Bible as a result of his own personal Bible reading. I just don't believe a guy that's riding around his car listening to rock and roll music and watching TV all night and getting up in the morning and reading his chapter before he goes to work, I don't think that man suddenly remembers as he's reading Chronicles that that number of years doesn't match what he read 3 months ago in Samuel. I'm not buying it. I believe every one of these lists comes from 2 or 3 books that were put out by infidels 200 years ago during the days of colonial America. I've got those books, and I haven't seen any new thing come along yet. When these guys send me these lists and say, I found these contradictions in the Bible, and I go pick up Ingersoll's book, and the list that this guy sent me is in the same order that Ingersoll's list was in, I know that guy is full of baloney. Now, look, if you honestly find in your Bible reading and Bible study something that appears to be a contradiction, you know what you're going to do? You're going to go to the Lord in prayer and to your pastor, and you're going to get an answer to that contradiction. And the reason these men have these big long lists of problems with the Bible they can't answer is because they didn't find those problems. Somebody else found them and gave them to them, and they didn't want to find the answers. They were so happy to have somebody give them an excuse for not submitting themselves to the Word of God that they just couldn't wait to try and make a doughhead out of somebody else. Now, I've found things in this Bible through the years in my reading that just puzzled me to no end. And I've got a file cabinet back there of questions that I had the very first time I read through my Bible. I was 18 years old and I wasn't saved yet. And I would write down Deuteronomy such and such, question mark, what does this mean? And every time I read through my Bible, I take that thing out. And every now and then I get to cross one of those off. But you'd be surprised how many of those questions are still there after 2.5 decades of studying this Bible. And I look at those and I say, praise God, I've got a book I can't figure out. Praise God, I have a book that is superior to my intellect. It's bigger than I am. It's more complex than I am. It's more detailed than I am. And I'm happy that it all crossed off the list because I got a reason to read it again and search it again and study it again. And there's verses I read in the Bible this day that don't make any sense to me at all. I had a guy write me this week and he said, Pastor, I trust your knowledge of the Bible. I have confidence in your understanding of the Word of God. Would you please explain to me that verse in the Psalms about dead things being formed under the waters? And I wrote him back and I said, no. I said, I don't know what it means. Nobody knows what it means. And anybody that says they do, I don't know what they got to say. Man, you really expect to understand every word of the Bible? I read that thing as a young Christian said, whoso breaketh an hedge, a serpent will bite him. Why is that in the Bible? What in the world does that mean? I read something like that. I pray about it. I say, Lord, I don't know what this means. And I've found most of those things. You go to the commentaries and they just skip right over it. One dear brother of ours who should be nameless, if you get a real hard passage, you go to his commentary, he'll say, any moron knows what this means. And just goes right on by. Meaning, I don't know what it means either, but I'm going to make you think I do. So I'm out one day, I'm carrying the mail. And I walked up to this house and put the mail in the box. And I turned around to walk back down the driveway to go around the hedge to go to the next house, and I thought, why should I do that? And so I started to make my way through that hedge, and bang, into my mind came, whoso breaketh the hedge, a serpent will bite him. You know what I was doing? I was taking a shortcut. You take shortcuts, you're liable to run into the devil. There are no shortcuts in the Christian life. You're going to have to go all the way around that obstacle. You can't take corners, you can't take shortcuts. But that was 15 years after I first read that verse and got puzzled by it. And there it came. So I read a lot of things in the Bible. I don't know what they mean. I don't know what they're talking about. I don't know what the application is. I don't know what the interpretation is. So you know what that means? It's none of my business today. And I don't need it today. And if it was my business today and I did need it today, the Holy Ghost of God who leadeth me, O blessed thought, would give me the light that I need on that passage. Why change the Bible just because there's some obscure places therein? Why not just leave it alone? Now here's what's going to happen. You're going to change the Bible, or the Bible is going to change you. And it can't be both ways. Once you begin to alter the Word of God, it can no longer alter you. I'm going to allow that book to alter me. Change my course, change my direction, correct the contradictions that exist in me. Imagine this dust ball still struggling with the same sins he was struggling with the day he got saved. Still fighting the same hang-ups he was fighting the day he got saved. Taking it upon myself to fix the Bible. Now, my position is a little different than some of these guys. I don't think all these fellows who put out these new versions are satanic or full of the devil. I don't. I just think they got ego problems. I think some of them really love the Lord. I think some of them are sincere in their desire to do something for Jesus. I sat in the home of a man and his wife who worked on the NIV translation. I sat in their living room. And we went back and forth. I used everything I knew at age 22. to tell them why they were wrong. And the man laughed. He said, "Young man, you're not telling us anything we don't know. Of course there's errors in our translation. We're fragile. We made mistakes. There's errors in all translations. Can I fix your supper?" That man was good to me. He was kind to me. He prayed with me. He was 77 years old and still knocking on doors trying to win people to Jesus. He just thought he was smart enough to fix the Bible. He wasn't a devil. He wasn't satanic. He was a very kind, loving Christian man who just too big for his britches. Okay, so seeing that upsets some of you. Oh, they're all satanic. They're all going to hell. Come on. Some of you got saved reading the Good News for Modern Man. Some of you got saved with a preacher in the pulpit using a Living Bible or an NIV. That's right. It's not the Word of God. Gospel tract's not the Word of God, but it's got the gospel in it. Come on. You can write the plan of salvation on the wall. That doesn't mean you got to take that wall home because it's the Word of God. I mean, see, here's what you got to be careful. You got to be careful of making these rash statements that you can't support because they just discredit you. I was at this big meeting one time, and Brother Gipp was there, and Sister Ripplinger, and all the big names that you'd know. And then I was there, and you know, people read the lineup, and they say, "Who's this guy? You know who he is?" "No, I never heard of him. Anybody ever heard of him?" "No, I never heard of him." But anyway, so we were there, and I said, "I'm just curious. Aren't you all glad that God opened your eyes and showed you the truth about the King James Bible?" "Yeah, man!" Everybody's putting their hands in the air. I said, how many of you, after you got saved, God opened your eyes and showed you the truth about the King James Bible?" "Yeah, 3/4 of them put their hands up." I said, "Now how many of you holding up your hands have said since that time that if you don't have a King James Bible, you're not saved?" So you got to be careful. There's a lot of people with King James Bibles that aren't saved. A lot of people reading the right book but coming out with a wrong heart. So anyway, that's just enough to get everybody puzzled and confused. The Bible's right. It's one book. It's God's Word. It has no errors in it. But there are saved people who don't know that. And there are people who know that who aren't saved people. You can't determine who's saved and who's lost on the basis of a doctrine. You're only saved if you trust Christ as your Savior. And you're lost if you don't. So anyway, let's look at some of these contradictions and see if we can solve some of these riddles. Genesis 46 and Acts chapter 7. Genesis chapter 46 and Acts chapter number 7. Street work, Brother Gibson, will round off some of the rough edges on you. Won't make you harder, it'll make you softer. When people that don't agree with every point of doctrine that you agree with come and stand with you and pray with you and support you when you're out there preaching the gospel, you come to understand that that rapture is going to include more than people that see everything my way. Bible says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved." And there's no amendments to that. I'm glad of that. All right, Genesis 46, verse 24 says, "And the sons of Naphtali, Jahaziel and Guni, and Jezer and Shillem, these are the sons of Bilhah, which Laban gave unto Rachel his daughter. And she bare these unto Jacob. All the souls were 7. All the souls that came with Jacob into Egypt, which came out of his loins, besides Jacob's sons' wives, all the souls were 66. And the sons of Joseph, which were born in Egypt, were 2 souls. All the souls of the house of Jacob, which came into Egypt, were 70. Okay, keep your finger right there. Acts chapter 7. Stephen is preaching. The Bible says in verse 13, "And at the second time Joseph was made known to his brethren, and Joseph's kindred was made known unto Pharaoh. Then sent Joseph and called his father Jacob to him, and all his kindred 75 souls. Now, that's 75. In that Genesis account, you had 66. That's 66. In the Acts account, you have 75. That's supposed to be a reason to throw away your Bible. Okay, now, look at Genesis very carefully and watch your commas. You've got parenthetical commas. We have an additional clause added that is not necessary to complete the sentence. Verse 26, all the souls that came with Jacob into Egypt, which came out of his loins, all the souls were 66. Who is not included in that count? Besides Jacob's sons' wives. It's very clearly stated. There are some people not included in the Genesis 46 count. Besides this group, there were 66. Stephen makes no such distinction. He gives you the grand total, if you will, of 75, which includes the sons' wives, Jacob's sons' wives. So what's the problem? Somebody was handed a list of contradictions, mailed it to Brother James with a smirk on their face, and didn't read the verse. Verse is clear. No problem whatsoever. Numbers 25 and 1 Corinthians 10. Numbers 25 and 1 Corinthians 10. Out of this list of 101 contradictions, there are about four that are a real problem. And the rest of them are no trouble at all. Numbers 25, 1 Corinthians 10. This is a good preaching spot here. Numbers 25, verse 1. And Israel abode in Shittim, and the people began to commit whoredom with the daughters of Moab. And they called the people unto the sacrifices of their gods, and the people did eat and bow down to their gods. Here's a Bible fact from one end of the Bible to the other. When a man joins himself to a woman who worships a different god than he does, every case from Genesis to Revelation, the woman turns the man from his god to her god. Every time. Young fellas, you just better write that down right now. If you want to spend your life in a Bible-believing church and raise children that fear God and believe His Word, you better marry a girl that worships the Lord Jesus Christ. If you marry somebody else, she will turn your heart. That's Bible. That's the Bible, one end to the other. All right, verse 3, and Israel joined himself unto Baal Peor, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and the Lord said unto Moses, take all the heads of the people and hang them up before the Lord against the sun. Aren't you glad you're in the New Testament, not the Old? Your pastor starts going to Moses for teaching on pastoral authority. You better look out. He's liable to hang your head up in the fellowship hall. Says that the fierce anger of the Lord may be turned away from Israel. And Moses said unto the judges of Israel, slay ye every one his men that were joined unto Baal Peor. And behold, one of the children of Israel came and brought unto his brethren a Midianitish woman in the sight of Moses and in the sight of all the congregation of the children of Israel. Now, that's pretty brazen, isn't it? He's not even trying to hide his sin. He's just right in front of the preacher and everybody who were weeping before the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. There's some people trying to get right. They're grieving about this thing. And somebody walks right through the middle of them. They don't care. And Bible says when Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, saw it, he rose up from among the congregation and took a javelin in his hand. And he went after the man of Israel into the tent and thrust both of them through, the man of Israel and the woman through her belly. So the plague was stayed from the children of Israel. Man, I'm glad I'm in a spiritual setup, not a physical setup. It's pretty rough, isn't it? Now watch. And those that died in the plague were 24,000. So God's dropping them dead. The ones that Israelites didn't execute themselves, all told is 24,000 dead. All right, don't lose the place. 1 Corinthians 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And let's start reading at verse number 6. Now these things were our examples to the intent we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. Neither be idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. Okay, now there's the problem. Numbers says 24,000. You got 24,000. 1 Corinthians says 23,000. You got 23,000. But again, it's not a problem. Read the words. Look at 10:8. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day. 23,000. 1 Corinthians gives you the count for the one day when God sent this plague through the camp. There's obviously 1,000 people that linger past midnight, that tarry until the morning light and die the following day. There's 24,000 died of the plague according to Numbers. 23,000 of them died in one day. This is so common that it's just hard to believe that people attack the Word of God over this thing. I don't know how many people died on September 11th in New York City when the airplanes flew into the towers. But I am certain that the newspaper reports that gave an account of how many died that day have since been revised to give the total who died as a result of the terrorist attack. Some people lingered with injuries. Some people lingered with ailments and then eventually succumbed and gave up the ghost, and they would be included in the total who died in that terrorist attack, though they didn't die on September the 11th, 2001. Now, if you give the newspaper that liberty, how dare you not give the Holy Bible that liberty? Numbers gives the total. 1 Corinthians gives the one-day count. All right, 1 Samuel 28 and 1 Chronicles chapter 10. 1 Samuel 28 and 1 Chronicles chapter number 10. First Chronicles 10. All right, 1 Samuel 28, verse number 5. Philistines have come up against Saul. And verse 5 says, when Saul saw the host of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart greatly trembled. And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets. Then said Saul unto his servants, seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I may go unto her, and so forth. All right, 1 Chronicles chapter 10 and verse number 13. In fact, let's start at verse 11. No, 13. 13 will be fine. So Saul died for his transgression which he committed against the Lord, even against the word of the Lord, which he kept not, and also for asking counsel of that of one that had a familiar spirit to inquire of it, and inquired not of the Lord. Therefore he slew him and turned the kingdom unto David the son of Jesse. Now, I'm telling you, these are just people that don't like the Word of God. The argument here is that Samuel says that Saul inquired of the Lord, and Chronicles says he didn't inquire of the Lord. Come on. Chronicles is very, very specific. Saul had previously inquired of the Lord many times. But we are given the account in 1 Chronicles 10 of the reason Saul died. Saul died because on a particular day, he didn't inquire of the Lord, but instead inquired of a familiar spirit through a witch at Endor. And the Bible says, if you look at verse 13, even, see that word, even against the Lord. Verse number 14, therefore he slew him. Because of that one instant, when instead of inquiring of the Lord, he inquired of this familiar spirit, for that cause, God slew him, put him to death. Chronicles doesn't say Saul never inquired of the Lord. He did so many times, but this time he didn't. And because of his choice of mediators, because of his choice in who to pray to, God said, therefore, because of that, even that, I killed Saul, put him to death. No problem with the Bible. Again, it's just a problem with reading. All right, Genesis 11, Luke 3, and Matthew 1. Genesis 11, Luke 3, and Matthew 1. James Randi, R-A-N-D-I, is a brilliant man. Probably one of the most intelligent men in the world today. He's a professional magician. James Randi got a team of men together, and he infiltrated several of the largest healing ministries in America and exposed them for being the frauds that they are. James Randi's dealings with hucksters and phonies who use Jesus' name has made an infidel out of him. And Randi sits down and reads and studies the Bible like Isaac Asimov did, and Steve Allen, these fellows. And they write books, that they study the Bible to look for these things that are wrong, and then they write these books. Then people pick up those books and read them, and say, well, I'm not going to believe the Bible. I read this book one time about all the contradictions in the Bible. Now, the reason those people die lost is because of John chapter number 3. Men love darkness rather than light, and they will not come to the light because their deeds are evil. I have read Randi's books. I've read Asimov's books, and I have also read God's book and a multitude of books defending God's book because I'm honest. And when a man says, I don't believe the Bible because I read a book that said there was a bunch of things wrong with the Bible, and he has not read the Bible and will not read someone who refutes the arguments of those who oppose the Bible, that man damns his soul because he's dishonest. He doesn't want light. He loves darkness. He seeks out those who will help him remain comfortable in the darkness. And it's not God's fault that a man like that dies and goes to hell. They're gonna sit in hell and shake their fist at God and say, it's your fault. You never told me. You never warned me. And that reprobate would spend $30 on a book written by another reprobate to help him justify not reading the Bible rather than read the Bible for himself. Is that fair? That's John 3. That's what it's all about. A man could have the truth if he wanted it. And when these guys send you these lists of 100 contradictions in the Bible, or, you know, your dad or your aunt or your brother sends you an email, and, you know, you send him a gospel tract, and he sends you an email and says, well, what about the age of Azariah? You know what the problem is with that guy? He would rather die and go to hell listening to somebody who doesn't know what they're talking about than let you give him the gospel so he could have eternal life because his heart's bad. Why would a guy read a gospel tract with an offer of eternal life and then go looking through the internet to find somebody that wrote an article critical of the Bible? Why would you do that unless you just wanted to die in your sins? Problem's not with the Bible, people. It's with the human heart. Problem's in the heart. All right, Genesis chapter 11. Genesis 11 and verse number 13. Start at 12, and Arphaxad, lived 35 years and begat Selah. And Arphaxad lived after he begat Selah 403 years and begat sons and daughters. Now, I want to ask you a question. I want you to be honest with me. Have any of you, I trust you read your Bible through once a year or more, have any of you ever read Genesis 11, verse 13, and thought to yourself, I wonder what the rest of the Bible says about the sons of Arphaxad? Now, do you really think a lost man is sitting in his office at the university, reading the Word of God on his lunch break, and as he reads Genesis 11, he says, I vaguely remember a problem with the Arphaxad lineage in Luke. I'm not buying it. Luke chapter 3 says this. Arphaxad begat Selah, according to Genesis 11. Luke chapter 3, verse 35. Which was the son of Serach, which was the son of Ragau. Yeah. Ragu. It's Italian. Which was the son of Phalek, which was the son of Eber, which was the son of Selah, which was the son of Cainan, which was the son of Arphaxad, which was the son of Sam, which was the son of Noe, which was the son of Lamech. So here's the deal. Selah is Arphaxad's son in Genesis 11, but Arphaxad's grandson is given that designation in Luke chapter number 3. Okay, how do you solve that problem? Well, first of all, let me ask you if it really is a problem. Sitting here tonight, in our midst, we are honored to have with us Carolyn John's son. And it's been so many centuries since John had a son that nobody has any idea which John's son Carolyn came from. But she still bears that name. There are men in our town named Paul's son, Samuel's son, Christian's son. And they are so many generations removed from the father who gave his son that designation that you couldn't trace it if you spent the rest of your life in the library reading that little microfiche. So here's a guy sitting in his library named Paulson. And he says, well, the King James Bible's in error here because it says the grandson was somebody's son. Well, why don't you change your name? Instead of calling yourself Ron Paulson, call yourself Ron Paul's great, 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 great to the 10th power son. You see how hypocritical people are? Now, watch the Bible handle this problem with ease. Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. And verse number 1. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And then you are going to have 14 steps from Jesus to David. And 14 steps from David to Abraham. And yet the Word of God can rightly call Jesus Abraham's son, omitting the 28 steps that are here, which omits dozens of steps which are in Chronicles, and it matters not because as long as you are part of the generation, you are one of the sons. If eventually you can trace that line back to Shem, you can rightly be called Shem's son. Nobody has to call me tonight the umpteenth grandson of Japheth. That's who I came from. I'm his son. Matter of fact, I'm Adam's son. But better than that, I'm God's son. How's that? The Pharisees even understood this. Look in Matthew chapter 22. Matthew 22. Anyone in the generations can be called a son of, because he is of that man's seed, no matter how far down the line he might be. Matthew 22, verse 41. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?" Now, they didn't think that Jesus was Christ, so they're still looking for him. They've been looking for him for a long time. They are still looking for him, but watch their answer. "Whose son is he?" They say unto him, "The son of David." Well, if he was the son of David, he would have had to have lived and died hundreds of years before he asked the question. And yet they're still looking for Messiah to come. How could they call him the son of David? Because they understood that as long as he came out of David's loins, as long as he was part of David's lineage, he could rightly be called David's son. So, when somebody tries to create a contradiction between Genesis 11 and Luke 3, man, they're farther gone than the Pharisees were. Even the Pharisees understood how that lineage and son designation worked, and I hope you do too. All right, Genesis 6 and Genesis 7. Genesis chapter 6 and Genesis chapter 7. This has to do with critters. Critters on the ark. Genesis 7 verse 1. Now let's do 6 first. Genesis 6, 19. God is speaking to Noah. "And of every living thing of all flesh, two of every sort shalt thou bring into the ark to keep them alive with thee. They shall be male and female. Fowls after their kind, of cattle after their kind, of every creeping thing of the earth after his kind, two of every sort shall come unto thee to keep them alive." First of all, to argue that the ark wasn't big enough to hold two of every animal is to misread the Bible. God didn't say every species, he said every kind. There's all he's got to have is two cats on that ark with the material in their genetic makeup to father and to give birth to all of the variations that would show up after that trip on the ark. Okay, that's what he said. He said two of each kind. Get two from that family, two from that family, two from that family, two from that family, and get them on the ark and we'll be okay. That means that God was not concerned with preserving every species. That means that many species were more than endangered when that flood came. They became extinct. And guess what? We got more varmints running around now than we know what to do with. Don't you worry, there'll always be critters here. You won't ever run out of little bunnies and little rats and rodents and cockroaches and mice and all that. They'll always be here. But God, I preached one night. This is true what I'm telling you. I preached in North Carolina on the flood, and God sent that flood and drowning all those people in that flood. And I said, that's proof of God's judgment. If you don't believe God will put you in hell, you better read the story of the flood. If you weren't in that ark, you drown. Just as sure as you were living and breathing, you drown. And God will put you in a lake of fire as sure as you're living and breathing if you're not in Christ. I got through, and this woman came storming. I mean, I hadn't even got to, she came storming up. She said, "Let me tell you something, mister. If your God let ponies drown in the flood, I don't want him." I said, "What about Grandma?" That's that thing we read Sunday night, without natural affection. She wasn't upset about all those people drowning the flood. She was upset about the Rainbow Princess pony drowning in the flood. All right, Genesis 7. This is supposed to be the contradiction here. Verse 1, "The Lord said unto Noah, Come thou and all thy house into the ark." Ooh, I like that. He didn't say go into the ark. He said come into the ark. Looks like Noah had a captain on board that ship, doesn't it? For thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens, the male and his female, and of the beasts that are not clean by two, the male and his female, the fowls of the air by sevens, the male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of all the earth. Now, in one place it says two, in the other place it said seven, and personally I think it's two pairs. I don't think he took two of each kind. I think he took four. He took two pairs. And the reason I say that is you got the male and his female, and you got seven. Well, some male or some female is getting left out. So it looks to me like you got 14 of the clean and four of the unclean. And this is not a contradiction. This is additional information. Here's how it works. You got kids. If you have kids, this is not a contradiction. You know exactly how it works. You call Junior in. This doesn't happen at our house. It used to, but it doesn't anymore. And you say, now here's what I want you to do. I want you to get the broom. And I want you to sweep the porch. And when you're done sweeping the porch, I want you to go over there and get that pile of trash picked up and get it in the garbage. Now, when you said, I want you to get the broom, your son began to calculate how long it was going to be before he could get back to doing what he wanted to do. And in his mind, he's headed off to get the broom to sweep the carport, which is good. But he gets done sweeping the carport and returns to something that he felt was more important, like his math homework or, you know, whatever. And you come home from work and you say, hey, isn't it amazing? This is what I say. I don't know what you say. I say, it's amazing, son. After you worked so hard to pick up that trash and get it in the garbage, somebody took it back out of the trash and scattered it back in the yard. A little sarcasm kind of breaks the tension. And he says, with all honesty, Dad, I didn't hear you say anything about the trash in the yard. Because he heard the first instruction and then went in that direction. Now, Noah is told, I want you to get two of every kind of animal. That's the first instruction. And then he starts to walk off and God says, no, wait, I'm not done. That's the unclean animals. Every clean animal, I want you to get seven of them. Oh, okay, Lord. So there's an additional bit of instruction given. Okay, why? I have to tell you. All right, turn to Genesis chapter 9. I'm sorry, chapter 8 and verse number 20. And Noah builded an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. If Noah had only taken the minimum number of the clean animals, he would not have had clean animals to offer God in sacrifice. Or if he had offered clean animals to God in sacrifice, that kind would have been gone forever. And so God in His wisdom said, I want you to take seven of the clean animals so you will have that with which to offer unto me when you get out on the other side of this flood. There was never any doubt Noah was going to make it through that flood. And then there were three other reasons why he took seven of the clean animals. Three other reasons. Let me show you. Verse number one of chapter 9, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea, and into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even as the green herb have I given you all things. Okay, in Genesis 9:3 are the three additional reasons why Noah took seven of the clean animals, and they are breakfast, lunch, and supper. Look, if you only take one cow, and the first day off the boat, you have a barbecue, there's no more cows for the rest of us to enjoy thousands of years later. Okay, so the animals that were clean, that were there given to man by God for food, there's extra on board so that when Noah and his family get off the ark, they don't have to live on a vegetarian diet. I'm going to get all the questions as soon as church is over, but what about if eating meat would kill you, then God saved these people in the ark to kill them when they got off? Well, Noah, here's the catch. You survive the flood, but go eat porky and get trichinosis and drop dead. Be a cruel joke, wouldn't it? Noah lived several hundred years on that diet. All right, anyway. There's no contradiction. He took extra animals for those reasons. Amen. That's horrible. No, it'd been horrible if he'd have eaten Shem or Ham or Japheth. That would have been horrible. But and then the famous poem, I can't ever remember her name. This woman wrote, "If Noah had been truly wise, he would have swatted those two flies." But that's all right, Genesis 17. We can tackle one more here quickly. Genesis 17, Acts 7, Hebrews 11. Genesis 17, Acts 7, Hebrews 11. You say, "Preacher, we're going to go through all these four through?" No, maybe not. Maybe I'll assign a couple to each of you. You can present your findings. Genesis 17, Acts 7, and Hebrews chapter 11. 17:8. God speaking to Abraham, and he says, "I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God." So God promises Abraham the land to live in for a possession. Acts 7, verse 5. Abraham comes out of the land of Canaan. Verse 5 says, "And he gave him none inheritance in it, no, not so much as to set his foot on. Yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession, and to his seed after him, when as yet he had no child." Now let me ask you something. Do you think if this is a problem in the Bible, a contradiction or God lying, that the Holy Ghost is going to have Stephen use this in his address to the nation of Israel in Acts 7? Fellows, I want to begin with point number one. God lied to Abraham. I'm not buying it. You know what Stephen is going to preach in Acts chapter number 7? That Jesus Christ rose from the dead. You know who he's preaching to? A large company of Sadducees who don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. And he says, let me tell you something, fellas. If God promised Abraham he'd live in that land, and Abraham died and never possessed one square foot of that land, either you guys believe in a resurrection or your God's a liar. That's where he's going. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11 and verse 8. "By faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise." Verse 13. "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having received them, seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth." Now that's faith. Here's a man holding in his arms and clutching to his bosom something that he can't touch. That's faith. It's the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. Now look in your Bible in Matthew 22. We'll go quickly. Matthew 22. If you're living by faith tonight in a resurrection, the Bible says Abraham's your father. He got in on this thing way before you did. Matthew 22 and verse 23. Here's this bunch of Sadducees. "The same day came to him the Sadducees, which say that there is no resurrection, and asked him, saying, Master," watch out for that bunch that calls him Master, "Moses said, if a man die, having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up seed unto his brother. Now there were with us seven brethren, and the first, when he had married a wife, deceased, and having no issue, left his wife unto his brother. Likewise the second also, and the third unto the seventh. Last of all, the woman died also. Therefore in the resurrection, whose wife shall she be of the seven? For they all had her. Jesus answered and said to them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. Stop reading the Book of Mormon and read the Bible. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage. So there goes the bicycle boys, right? I mean, they're over. They're done. The whole thing's a farce if you believe that. So all you gotta ask the Mormon is, this New Testament, this other testament of Jesus, it contradicts the first testament of Jesus. Which one do you want me to believe? Because they're going to tell you Jesus spoke the truth and they believe the King James Bible and all that foolishness. No, they don't. There's no celestial marriage. Jesus said, you do err, not knowing the scripture of the power of God and the resurrection, they neither marry nor given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. But, as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, I am the God of Abraham, after he was dead, the God of Isaac after he was dead, and the God of Jacob after he was dead. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Now, you see what he's done? If God is the God of the living, and he refers to himself as the God of Abraham, then even though Abraham's bones are laying in the dust, Abraham's got to be alive. And if God promised him some land, he's going to get those bones up out of that dust and put Abraham back in that body and give him that land. You remember Luke 16? Abraham wasn't too dead. He was chatting with a rich man. That's not dead in my book. Now look at Ezekiel 37. We'll finish up here. Show you Abraham's future. These Israelites that died in faith, Hebrews 11 said, they hadn't received the promise yet, but they will. Watch what the Lord will do in a future day. Ezekiel 37, verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley which is full of bones. Abraham's bones out there somewhere. And caused me to pass by them round about. Behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. He said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. That's always a good answer. So God, you know, I don't know, you know. Again, he said to me, prophesy upon these bones, and say to them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. I will lay sinews upon you. There's that hippie talk. He's going to lay it on them. I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. The knee bone connected to the thigh bone, and the thigh bone connected to the hip bone, and there it is. When I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came up upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Now watch. Then said he unto me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say our bones are dried, and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. How about that? So Abraham gave up the ghost and they laid his bones in the ground, and he never took possession of the land. So what? God's not through with him. If God said Abraham's going to get that land, he's going to get that land. And if God has to put his body back together and then breathe life back into that body, put Abraham's soul back in that dwelling place, he can certainly do it. Hallelujah. I've got eternal life. And if I die tomorrow, don't you let that change your mind. You stand over my body at that funeral, you say, he's got eternal life. He just checked out of this thing for a while. God's going to overhaul it and move him back in one day. Right. Well, the problem's not with the Bible. And it's not really even with the people that misreading the Bible. It's with people taking some infidel's word for what the Bible says instead of actually looking at the book for themselves. The Bible will stand. You just stand with it, and you come across something in the Bible you don't understand, just say, thank you, Lord. Got something to look forward to next time through. That means you still got more to do in my life. Something you hadn't shown me yet. I don't need it today, so I guess I'll need it tomorrow. Amen. Just leave the Bible be. Our Father in heaven, thank you for giving us the faith to believe your word. Lord, may we never surrender that faith to somebody who has nothing to offer us in return. Lord, if a man came along and said he had a perfect book to replace our perfect book, well, it might be worth listening to. But God, when somebody comes along and says they have nothing and they want to take our perfect book away, Lord, give us sense enough to never fall for that. God, thank you for your Bible. Help us to love it, study it, read it, believe it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.